I think the best refutation I've ever heard to the argument that religion helps people cope with death is listening to religious people try to cope with death. Their holistic failure should surprise nobody, of course. There are literally no problems on the fucking planet that are easier to deal with by lying to yourself about them and pretending they don't exist. But somehow people always seem to think that this one is the exception. So look, I don't mean to keep laying down such heavy diatribes on you, but I can either talk about what I'm thinking about or I can offer you up thoughtless words. And right now I'm dealing with a man that's at the end of his life trying to come to grips with that fact. And it's really hard to think about anything else when that's happening right next to you, especially when so much diatribe-worthy shit keeps happening in conjunction with it. And I have to not yell fuck at anybody when it happens because I'm in a hospital at the moment. Like, let me give you a great example. And luckily, I wasn't here for this one because there's only so much not yelling fuck at anybody that I've got in me. The other day, my father-in-law calls up a childhood friend of his that he still talks to, you know, once every year or two. And he has a pretty hard conversation with him. He wants this buddy of his to be the guy that tells their whole crew when he dies, right? Rather than reading about it in the paper or hearing about it 2 years later or something, he wants this guy to call up all their mutual friends after the fact and tell them that he's gone. So far, so depressing. But it turned out that the old friend in question became a pastor somewhere along the way. So the conversation winds up being way worse than it needs to be. Because instead of just saying, yes, of course, I will honor my friend's dying wishes. Is there anything else that I can do for you? This asshole starts yammering about making himself right with the Lord and accepting Jesus as his personal savior. But it gets worse. Okay, because not only is he putting my father-in-law through that fucking ecclesiastical timeshare pitch bullshit when he should be shutting the fuck up and letting his friend talk, he also denies the premise. He starts talking about all that miraculous healing that Jesus can offer for the low, low price of one immortal soul. He's telling him not to lose hope and that God knows things that them doctors don't know. And he just needs to put his hands together and trust in Jesus Christ Almighty. Can I get an amen? Now, you know, look, like I've said before, my father-in-law is vaguely religious. If you ask him his religion, he'll tell you Christian, but there'll be a little tiny question mark at the end of the statement, right? He's not a churchgoer, and he is certainly not a person who wants to waste any of his precious remaining minutes of life listening to some fucking pastor yammer on about how he has just the right magical spell for a time like this, and the last fucking thing he needs is false hope. Can you imagine how hard it is to make that goddamn call? To hold the awareness of one's own mortality in the front of your mind long enough to get to the point of that conversation, and then to have somebody ignore the profundity of that awareness on the word of a goddamn fairy tale is more than stupid. It's selfish. It's a way for that pastor to avoid having to have a really hard conversation, to hide from reality instead of sharing in my father-in-law's pain for a minute and really being a fucking friend. Because it's easier to pretend that there's a miracle around the corner than it is to recognize that he actually is going to come to the same end as the rest of us. Now, Lucinda was there at the time. Her dad just held the phone away from his ear and rolled his eyes until all the Jesus words were over. But then he put it back to his ear. He offered up an awkward well anyway and got off the line. And then she, of course, swooped in to try to undo all the damage that jackass pastor just did. Instead of being comforted, he'd been dismissed. And it's not necessarily because the dude is a bad friend or a bad pastor or even a bad person. It's because religion hadn't equipped him with the tools that he would need to help a person in that situation. Yet despite how regularly they trot it out as their specialty, they never actually learn how to help people cope with death. Now, granted, that's a huge task. It might even be an impossible task. But it's not like the rest of us gave it to them as an assignment. It's something they took on for themselves. In fact, it's something that they jealously guard whenever more qualified end-of-life counselors try to encroach on their fucking turf. And if they so much as did the best they could, I think I'd cut them some slack. But as this anecdote illustrates, they don't just fail to help, they also hinder. How can we ever have realistic conversations about death if we're all obligated to pretend that it isn't final? How can we cope with our mortality if we're not even allowed to cop to it? In fact, I'd venture to say that the only way religion helps people come to terms with their mortality is that most forms of death that we're aware of are still more pleasant than dealing with fucking religious people.